Okay, calculus. So you have a test on Monday. So we're going to do this lesson today. I'm going to give you tomorrow as a study day. And I'm going to stop this duck fight that's happening below me. I'm going to give you a study day on Friday. And your test will be Monday. So this homework that I'm going to give you won't be due before like Tuesday morning. So I'll make it due like Monday night at midnight or something. So I will be looking for it Tuesday morning is when I'll be looking for it. And that way that'll give you lots of time to do it and me time to answer any questions I need to. So again, don't forget about your test on Monday at 2 o'clock. You'll just log in. It'll be there at 2. I'm going to give you till 3:30 to do it. All right. So we're going to move into chapter 6 though, right now. Chapter 6, they call curve sketching and optimization problems. Part of the point of calculus is being able to graph something. Yes, we're going into graphing. Is being able to graph something without having to sit and do a really long table of values, because sometimes the equation can be pretty complicated. And so if we can graph it without having to do a table of values, it can be a lot simpler. And some of the information that we can get will give us information about what's going on. So a graph just gives us a picture of what's going on. So right now in all this COVID stuff, you hear them talking about flattening the curve all the time. Well, they're referring to the graph, right? We want the cases to flatten out. But how do they do all the math that gets all that? Right now, statisticians have tons of work to do because they're crunching the numbers, doing the statistics constantly right now. There's even a couple of YouTube channels that keep live statistics of every country. It tells you right, like just up to the hour, how many cases, how many deaths, how many recoveries in each country, ranks the countries, has graphs of what all their curves look like. And someone has to keep those YouTube channels going. So there's all kinds of people working behind the scenes to make all that happen. And they're using actually a lot of the stuff that you're going to be learning in this chapter to do that. So they start you off very, very slowly. So we're going to move into what's called curve sketching. So we're going to learn how to sketch any curve without having to do a table of values and be able to give some important information about that graph as you go. So in section 6.1, they simply talk about increasing and decreasing, areas of increase and areas of decrease. So all that is if you have a graph, okay, and let's say the graph is doing this, okay, the part of the graph that is headed up, that is the increasing part of the graph. The part that's going down, that is the decreasing part of the graph. So increasing just means from left to right going up. Decreasing means from left to right going down. Doesn't matter where it is on the graph. If it's headed up, it is increasing. So even if it was here and then here, all of this is increasing because it's going up, and then it shifts to decreasing. So how do I know, without drawing a picture of it, where the graph is increasing and where the graph is decreasing? Well, one of the ways we do that is with the concept of a derivative. If you take the derivative of something at a certain point and stop. If you take the derivative at a certain point and the derivative works out to be positive, then your graph at that point is increasing. If you take the derivative and it works out to be negative, then that means at that point the graph is decreasing. Now, how do I know what points to pick, what points to check, all of those things? Well, that's what we're going to talk about. So I'm on page 314 in your textbook, and I am looking at example number one. And it says, without graphing it, so yay, no graphing, without graphing it, find the intervals on which the function negative x cubed plus 192x. So if that was my equation, where would that graph be going up? And where would that graph be going down? So when we're talking about where is it increasing and where is it decreasing, the first thing we do is we find the derivative. So if we find the derivative of this, this is negative 3x squared plus 192. Now, going back to that picture that I talked about, any picture, when it's increasing, the slope of any tangent line is positive because it's going this way. Here, the slope of any tangent line, which means the derivative, is headed down. It's going that way, so it's negative. The point at which it changes from going up to going down, because even if I draw a tangent line here, that is still a positive slope. That is still increasing. It's just increasing less quickly than, say, down here. But the point at which it changes, the slope is zero. The point where it goes from being one way to being the other way, at that point, the slope is zero. And remember that the slope is your derivative. So the point at which it can change from being increasing to decreasing or decreasing to increasing, the point at which it changes, at that point, the derivative is zero. So here's what we do. We found the derivative. We're actually going to make it equal to zero. And we're going to solve for that. So we're going to move the 192 over. We're going to divide this by negative 3. We're going to divide this by negative 3, which is going to give me, I think, 64. Let me see. 3 goes into, that's 6, and that, yeah, it's 64 is x squared. And so if I take the square root of that, that is plus or minus 8. That is plus or minus 8. Those are what we call the critical numbers. Those are actually something called critical numbers. Those are the places where this graph could change from increasing to decreasing or decreasing to increasing. So really, these are intervals. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to say, listen, we could go from negative infinity up to, oh, stop. We could go from negative infinity up to negative 8. So think about a number line. Here's negative 8, here's 8. We could go from negative infinity up to negative 8, and that would be interval notation, right? That would be interval notation. And then we could do this section here, which is negative 8 to 8. Again, interval notation. And we could go from 8 onwards, so from 8 to infinity. Now, what I'm going to do is I'm going to pick a number, any number I want, in each of those sections. I'm going to put it back into the derivative. Don't put it back into the original. That's a mistake that people make. Put it back into the derivative. So between negative 8 and 8, if I pick the number negative 10, because that's a nice easy number, and I put it back into my derivative, I put it back into here, and I'm just going to erase this so that I have some space. So if I choose negative 10, if I decide that is my test, that's what I'm going to check. So negative 10 squared is positive 100 times negative 3, that's negative 300 plus 192. I don't even care what the answer is. All I care is, would that answer be positive or would that answer be negative? And negative 300 plus 192 would be a negative answer. So it wouldn't matter what number I pick to put in here, as long as it's between negative infinity and negative 8, I'm going to get a negative answer here. What that means is that the graph is decreasing, it's going down. Now, from negative 8 to 8, again, I can pick any number I want as long as it's between those two numbers. I'm going to put it back into the derivative, and I'm going to see whether I get a positive answer or a negative answer. So between negative 8 and 8, I would pick 0, because that's easy. So 0 squared, so I would end up with a positive 192 as an answer, so I would end up with a positive answer. If your answer is positive, that means that the graph is going up. It is increasing. I don't know how steeply. I don't even know where. I just know it is. And then 8 to infinity. So again, I can pick any number I want. I'm going to pick 10 because that seems easy. Sorry about the dogs. 10 squared is 100 times negative 3 is negative 300 plus 192. Again, don't care what the answer is. Just care whether it's positive or negative. Turns out it's negative, and so it's decreasing. So from negative infinity up to 8, negative 8, the graph's going down. Then from negative 8 to 8, the graph's going up. And then from 8 to infinity, the graph's going down. So this actually gives you a little picture of what the graph would look like. It would actually look something like that. Okay? So that's it. That's all we do. So we're going to look at example number 2. We're going to do 3 examples, by the way, just the first 3 examples. Apparently Wicket's not happy about that. Wicket. So, in example 2, it says a cell culture experiences changing environmental conditions and it has a rate of growth modeled by the function. The rate is 32t squared minus t to the fourth, and they tell us that t is anywhere from 0 to 6, and that's measured in hour. Okay, so what they're saying is you have like this petri dish and it's got cells in it, and for whatever reason the environment is changing, whether the temperature is changing, whether the amount of light is changing, something's changing, okay? And what we want to know is what impact is that having on the cells in that little petri dish. And the cells in this little petri dish are sitting there from 0 hours to 6 hours. So those are the only values I can look at, okay? Now it says the first thing we're going to do is we're going to find the derivative, because they want to know when is the growth rate increasing. So when is it going up? Increasing, going up. So we're going to do the derivative. So I'd bring this down. This would be 64t minus 4t cubed. All right. Now I make that equal to 0. And then with this one, you need to factor it. It's not going to solve nicely because there's a t in this piece and a t in this piece. But what I would do is I would take out 4t as a common factor. When I do that, I end up with 16 minus t squared. I end up with 16 minus t squared. He's going to be the smartest palm ever because he's learning calculus. So 16 minus t squared would actually break down to 4 minus t and 4 plus t because it's a difference of squares. So it could be that 4t piece equals 0, which means t is 0. It could be that 4 minus t equals 0, so t equals 4. Or it could be that 4 plus t equals 0, so t is negative 4. So my critical numbers are negative 4, 0, and 4. Now, negative 4 does not fall in here, so I wouldn't even bother testing it. I would do a little table where I would have from 0 to 4, and then from 4 to 6, because that's the only place that matters. Because our time after that doesn't matter, because they said we're only looking from 0 to 6 hours. Hi. So now I would pick a number between 0 and 4, any number you want. I'd pick 1. I'm going to put it back into the derivative and see what I get. So if I put 1 in there, I'm going to get 64 minus 4. I'm going to get a positive answer, which means from 0 to 4 hours, the number of cells in that petri dish is increasing. So whatever environmental factors there are, it's favorable for them. So then from 4 to 6, again, I can pick any number I want, but I'm going to pick 5, because if I don't, I have to pick a decimal, and I don't want to do that. So if I pick 5, this would be 64 times 5 minus 4 times 5 cubed. Well, 5 cubed is 125. So if I work that out, I'm not going to bother, but if I work that out, it actually works out to be negative. Because it works out to be negative, that means it's decreasing. So from 4 to 6 hours, the number of cells in that petri dish actually starts decreasing. So obviously something has happened in the environment that the cells aren't happy with. Whether or not they've used up all the nutrition that's in that petri dish, and so now they're starting to starve to death. Whether suddenly the lights dimmed and they couldn't get energy from the light to reproduce, or maybe the temperature was too high and it started killing them off. Maybe it got too cold and they started freezing. Who knows? But something happened that at from the hours of 4 hours to 6 hours, those cells started dying off. And that's it. That's all that we have. So we have one more example. We have one more example. It's really hard to teach with him in my arms, so he's freaking out. Okay. This one is not as fun because, hi, you comfy yet? This one's not as fun because it has a fraction in it. So never as fun, right? So oil spills in the ocean are contained by various sizes of rectangular booms. All that means is, if an oil spill happens, they have these big rectangular, they're usually made of styrofoam now, pieces, they're long pieces, and they just put them out around the oil because oil floats on the water. If they can put something around it, it contains the spread of the oil because it doesn't go under anything because it's floating on top of the water. The formula is the total length of boom required for a particular rectangle. So they give it as B for boom is equal to 200,000 over W plus 3W. And they say, it says that relates the total length of the boom required for a particular rectangular design that has an area of 100,000 square meters with a width of W meters, for which the intervals of the width is the length, for which intervals of the width is the length of the boom decreasing. So there's a lot of big fancy words there, but regardless, what you're looking for is where is it increasing and where is it decreasing? Okay, that's really all you're looking for. So before I do the derivative for this one, I would actually write it as 200,000 W to the negative 1 plus 3W, so that I don't have to do the quotient rule in there because I don't wanna. So if I do the derivative of this, I bring the negative 1 down, I have negative 200,000 W to the negative 2, because if I subtract 1 from negative 1, I get negative 2. Plus, if I bring the 1 down, I end up with plus 3. So I could write, hi, you're not falling. So negative 200,000 over W squared, because I just brought the negative exponent down to the bottom, plus 3. That is my derivative. Now, I have to make that equal to 0. That kind of sucks. So 0 is equal to negative 200,000 over W squared plus 3. So I'm going to move this 3 over here. I have negative 3 is equal to negative 200,000 over W squared. So I'm going to multiply both sides by W squared. So I'm going to have negative 3W squared is negative 200,000. Okay, relax. So I'm going to divide this by negative 3. I'm going to divide this by negative 3. And I'm going to get W squared is whatever that is. So never mind. I'll just take the square root of this side and the square root of this side. And I get plus or minus, I'm trying to see, I'm getting old, plus or minus 258. But I don't have to pay attention to the negative, because remember, this is talking about width, W, width equals. Well, I can't have a negative width. That doesn't make any sense. So I'm just going to leave it there. So now I know that my test intervals are from 0 to 258. Because I can't, again, I'm not going to go below 0 because I can't have less than that. And 258 to infinity. So I'm going to take, I'm going to take any number I want and I'm going to put it back into the derivative. Doesn't matter whether you do it here or here, either one. But between 0 and 258, I'm going to choose 1. So negative 200,000 over 1 squared is negative 200,000 plus 3, definitely a negative number, so that is decreasing. And if I pick a number over 258, like, I don't know, 300 maybe, or even 1,000, doesn't matter, pick whatever you want, put it into here, you end up with a positive number, which means the length is increasing. So the length of the boom is decreasing as the width changes from 0 to 258. And as the width changes from 258 and bigger, then the length is increasing. And that's it. So I will post some questions for you to do. And again, they won't be due. I'll make them due like midnight Monday, so that Tuesday morning when I get up, I can take a look at it. So that gives you like from Thursday until then to do it. So lots and lots and lots of time. All right. So we'll see you on Monday. We'll talk to you. Well, no. We will communicate on Monday for your test at 2 o'clock. All right. See you later.